You're listening to KCAA Loma Linda at 106.5 FM, K293 CF Moreno Valley.
Welcome to the Journey to Business and Entrepreneurship. My name is Brianna. This is the show where we interview businesses and entrepreneurs about their journey and path through business and entrepreneurship. And today I am excited to have LaToya Tillett on the show for the second time. Hi, LaToya.
Hi, Brianna. Thank you so much for having me again.
Of course.
It's been like a year since we...
Yeah, you know, you were on the show during the... I think you may have been my like second show or something during the early days of having this show.
Yes.
So it's good to have you back on. Yeah, of course. Now, I know today we wanted to talk about taxes specifically, but before we get into that, you know... what I always like to do is give people an idea of who you are, just in case if they didn't hear your show from last year. So okay. Who you are and what it is that you do.
All right. My name is LaToya Tillett. I am an enrolled agent, meaning I have received the highest certification offered by the Internal Revenue Service, which you guys commonly know as IRS. I am the CEO of Tax Plus Financial Services and also a broker owner of Tillett Realty Group. So my main premise is to help clients create diverse portfolios and help my business owners save on their taxes. So we want to maximize your tax benefits with whatever type of business structure you choose.
Awesome. So how do you actually help people save on their taxes? I feel like that might be a big question to ask, but I'm going to go ahead and ask it now.
Yes. Okay. So there's a lot of layers that comes to that when we're talking about saving money on taxes. Main thing is with, of course, preparation, not necessarily just tax preparation, but I mean preparation all throughout the year. So if you're tracking your income, your expenses, also making sure you get the best deductions, that's pretty much how I help clients to prepare. I'll give them like worksheets that they can use to go ahead and keep track of everything that I'm going to be needing when I do prepare their tax returns. And so a lot of it comes with more so tax advice and advising. Mm-hmm. And to do that over a year-long period of time, because if you're starting right now, you're already a little bit behind, like we kind of talked about earlier. You should be planning for your taxes at the beginning of every single year for that upcoming year. So, you know, if you're already trying to scramble, because right now, what ends up happening is people miss out on a lot of deductions and different things that they probably could have taken because they're scrambling, looking for receipts because they're not organized. They're trying to remember where they stored that email invoice and different things like that. They may forget where they track some of the income. So when you're rushing, it creates an opportunity for you to miss out on certain deductions and extra tax benefits because you weren't technically prepared all throughout the year.
You know, you keep talking about different topics. I'm like, oh, I got a question. And then I'm like, wait, but we haven't even gotten into how you got into the tax business.
Oh, right.
So what made you actually go into taxes?
I actually got into taxes back in 2004. And the reason why is because I had my taxes prepared by a couple of different people. And both times I ended up owing, and I just got some really bad advice. One of the times, you know, the tax preparer told me, hey, you know, just file this one W-2 so you can get a bigger refund back. And then that way, you know, you don't have to worry about the other W-2s for 3 years, because that's when the IRS come looking for you. Mm-hmm. Lo and behold, IRS started looking for me within 6 months and garnished my paycheck. And I didn't like it.
I bet.
So I was like, okay, that's not cool. We're not going to do that anymore. And mm-hmm. So I started doing my own taxes and, you know, just started using, you know, software that I found online. And I'm like, oh, wow, I got a refund. And so I started telling people at work, I'm like, hey, you know, I did my taxes. I got this much refund. They're like, really? Well, can you do mine? And I'm like, sure, it's not that hard. I'm sure I did mine, right? So then it kind of just kept snowballing. And then people were like, oh, that's how you got me back so much money, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, oh, okay. And then it got to a point to where it was like, oh, okay, I'm doing more than 5 returns. So now I have to get certifications and, you know, I had to go get the P10 and everything. And then I have to get professional software so that I can e-file unlimited tax returns. So it just kind of like transitioned into a business. And then my aunt, who has been running my grandmother's business, Let's see, she started that business long, long, long time ago. I know my aunt's been working with her now since she was like 16, and she's like
Oh, wow.
76
Oh,
now.
wow.
So
Yeah, 60
she took over
years.
the business. Yeah, she took it over when my grandmother passed. And so, she was talking to my niece and I. She said, "Hey, you guys need to, create a business and everything, because I'm gonna have to eventually pass the tax business on to someone else." And so that's what kind of pushed me into getting the corporation to actually incorporate myself and make it a formal tax practice. And since then, pretty much just through word of mouth, I've just been getting a lot of clients, and I've just been evolving and learning more, because I don't want the things that have happened to me in taxes to happen to other people. I've been audited before, so I'm like, okay, what can I do to help other people to avoid these things, and what should they look out for? So that's pretty much why I'm here in the tax space.
I love that, and I think one question that I have that I'm pretty sure that a lot of people probably have asked themselves in the past is how do you know who's a good tax preparer and who's not? So, I've even myself have gone through different tax professionals as well, and it's hard to know who, and I maybe it kind of depends, because I realized as I got into real estate investing, I needed someone who actually knew about investing so that way they could better help assist me with what it is that I was doing.
Exactly. That would be my first tip. It depends on what you're doing. So, if you have a particular type of business, you want somebody who specializes in that type of business to get you the best returns, or to prepare your returns more accurately, I would say. So, choosing a tax preparer, of course, if you're a W-2, you can almost pretty much go anywhere. You can even do your own taxes online for free with the IRS. And some people, choose to go to H&R Blocks and, other places. I probably shouldn't mention their names, but you go to some larger tax preparation firms and everything, where they just do just straight simple returns, which is okay unless you have a business. When you have a business, you want someone who's more detail oriented and more specialized in what it takes to do business. So you want to look for someone who specifically specializes in small business, or one that's your exact business. So you'll want to look for someone who's familiar with doing tax returns for real estate investors, and they should know all of the deductions and everything that you should be reporting as a real estate investor. If you're a realtor, you might want to go to someone who, is a realtor like myself. I'm a broker, so I know what deductions and things that we can take, as far as in the real estate industry, and also as a real estate investor as well. And so that's pretty much how I would say, you look for a tax preparer. You want to check their credentials. If anyone is out there telling you, "Hey, I'll do your taxes and you give me 10% of what I get you back," run.
Oh, really? Why is it? Why do you say that?
Well, first of all, it's illegal for
Oh,
us
okay.
as paid tax preparers to take a percentage of someone's refund. And if they're telling you they're going to get you an extremely high refund, like if they say, "Hey, I can get you back $25,000," and you didn't work,
Probably
or
something shady going
you made
on.
$10,000, it's like, how are you going to get me back $25,000? I only made 10. So those are the kind of firms or preparers you want to stay away from. It might take them a while to get caught, but eventually they will. And then, the IRS is going to come looking at everybody that was involved. So I definitely would say, shy away from those type of preparers. We are, of course, allowed to charge reasonable prices for the preparation of your return based on the complexity. But if you hear anything that just sounds outrageous, and some people think, $250 outrageous, I'm not talking about that. That's really not a lot. But
No,
if someone's charging you, they're saying, "Oh, I'm getting you back 7 grand and I want half of it," then no, don't do that.
So what do you specialize in as a tax professional?
As tax professional, I've kind of graduated throughout the course of my career since 2004. I started, of course, with just basic W-2s, and then transitioned over into the Schedule C market. So I was focusing more on my Schedule C 1099 entrepreneur type returns. And now I'm more so into business. I got into in 2014 is when I started doing the S Corps, LLCs, and C Corporations. So I do specialize in small business under $50 million.
Nice. Okay. And earlier you were talking about how it's important to make sure that you're organized so that way you're not scrambling around and everything. What is some ways in which people can be organized with their deductions or with their expenses throughout the year?
Some of the ways, of course, will be tracking. There's apps to help you track things. Like if you're a 1099 contractor, you can use certain apps to track your mileage and track your expenses, like your lunches with clients, your gas, anything you have to pay for your business, your supplies. You can use accounting softwares like QuickBooks, FreshBooks, or some of the other ones, more popular ones that are out there. Those are just a couple of ways that you can keep track. And if you're old school and you like pen and paper, get yourself a journal and jot down every day what you're doing.
Oh my gosh.
I still have old school folks who do that. Like
that sounds terrifying.
Yeah, they'll send me like their whole journal with like everything written down and their receipts, like, you know, paper clipped in there for those days and everything. And I'm like, oh, okay, this is fun. But if you can do electronic, I definitely recommend electronic and also use a scanner to scan in receipts and invoices and make sure you keep those on hand. Because what happens is, you know, some of these receipts, the paper, the ink starts to go away for a little while. So if you're not scanning your receipts in, I would say at least weekly, scanning in your receipts of what you're spending while you're out and about and keeping a folder of that. So you have everything organized in detail, because what's going to happen is you just hold on to those receipts until next year when it's time to file. Some of them won't be readable and you may not be able to take that deduction.
I have a question, because I heard once that you actually have to make sure that you have the receipt, even whether it's scanned or whatever. You can't just rely on statements like your bank statements. Like if you have a credit card and you're paying for stuff, you can't just rely on that. Is that accurate?
It's not all the way true. It is better to have the receipt, but as long as you have some type of record. So if it is in your credit card statement or it is in your bank statement, you can also use that
well. Okay. Because I was going to say, that's something that I've always done. I feel like it's so much easier to track by, you know, I pay everything with my credit card. So it's easier for me with one particular credit card. So that way it's easy for me to track everything in that sense. Because I hate receipts. Yeah. I don't like them.
I know. It is best to have the receipts, but as long as you have some type of mechanism where you can show that expense and at least a detailed record of what it is, then you should be okay.
Okay. Now, I do want to ask you a little bit about like S-corps, C-corps, all that stuff. What is the difference between those?
You want to take a break first?
You know, I figure, you know what? Let's go ahead and do that, actually. We'll be right back with you guys in just a moment.
All right.
KCAA Radio has openings for one-hour talk shows. If you want to host a radio show, now is the time. Make KCAA your flagship station. Our rates are affordable and our services are second to none. We broadcast to a population of 5 million people. Plus, we stream and podcast on all major online audio and video systems. If you've been thinking about broadcasting a weekly radio program on real radio plus the internet, contact our CEO at 281-599-9800. 281-599-9800. You can Skype your show from your home to our Redlands, California studio, where our live producers and engineers are ready to work with you personally. A radio program on KCAA is the perfect work from home avocation in these stressful times. Just type kcaaradio.com into your browser to learn more about hosting a show on the best station in the nation, or call our CEO for details. 281-599-9800.
Welcome back to the Journey to Business and Entrepreneurship. My name is Brianna. This is a show where we interview businesses and entrepreneurs about their journey and path through business and entrepreneurship. Today, I have LaToya Tillett here, who is a tax professional, and we are definitely asking her advice today. So, LaToya, before we went on break, I asked a large question of, you know, what's the difference between, you know, even getting an LLC, a C-corp, S-corp, all that stuff. So what are the differences between those?
Okay, so the differences between those. So first you have to sit down and figure out what type of business it is that you're doing and what type of entity is going to best fit what your business model is going to be.
Okay.
A lot of times what happens is whenever someone wakes up and decides, "Hey, I want to start a business, I'm going to get an LLC."
Right.
Nobody really explains to them exactly what an LLC is.
Right.
So I'll break it down briefly. So an LLC is pretty much a hybrid when it comes to business entities. And so when I say it's a hybrid between being a full corporation and being an individual. So if you go in as a sole person, so like if, Brianna, you just go up there and say, "Hey, I'm just gonna open an LLC." You don't have any partners, it's just you by yourself. You're really gonna be doing yourself a disservice because an LLC for a single member, which is what they call a single member LLC, it is a disregarded entity and not recognized by the IRS. So you still have to file that on a Schedule C. So what you're in turn doing is you are paying taxes double from what you should be paying because you're not only paying the whatever your tax bracket is. So let's just say this. Let's say you made a net $100,000 in your business, right? Your tax bracket on the individual level will be 24%. So that's $24,000 right there on that net $100,000 income. Then you have to turn around and pay 15.3% on that same $100,000 from your business income. So now you're at 39.3%. So that's $39,300 in taxes right there because you wanted an LLC. And then if you live in California and some other states, you got to pay annually for that LLC no matter whether you sell anything or make any money or not. So then now you have that plus 39.3% taxes. So you could have saved yourself a lot of money by just being a corporation, either an S corp or a C corp, because you got a 21% flat tax rate for corporations.
So if someone has
See
an,
the difference there?
yeah, that's interesting. So if someone has an LLC and you just gave great advice about, basically it's useless if you're a single person or, a one person, one man ship or whatever you want to call it, you're better off with, I assume, an S corp or a C corp. I don't know the differences between the two. But if it's just you, would it be an S corp or a C corp, or does it could it go either
If
way?
it's just you, it could be either way. So
Oh,
it's
good. Okay.
if you do have an LLC, you can elect to be taxed as an S corp or a C corp. So that way you'll get all those benefits and you have the lower tax rate and everything. But unfortunately, when people go to some of these places I won't name, they won't necessarily explain all of that to them. They'll just be like, "Oh, you just pay the filing for the LLC and you're good to go. We seen your big pretty book and everything, and you're off and running." But they're not explaining to you the differences and being, an LLC but electing to be taxed as a different entity if you choose to stick with the LLC. The difference is with an S corp, it's called a subchapter S. With this one, it flows through. So like an LLC, if you have a partnership, the S corp allows the profits and losses to flow through to your personal tax return. And so what that means is you save as far as paying taxes on the corporate level.
Oh,
So you
interesting.
bypass the corporate level taxes and then you're only paying on the individual side, right? Which sometimes could be a lot lower depending on if your company has a loss or not, or it had minimal income. S corps really go up to revenue of 250,000. Once you start making over $250,000 annually, then you have to switch over and become a C corp. You also are limited to the amount of shareholders you can have in an S corp, which is only 100 people. So, if you, I don't know who want to have to deal with 100 people, but if you want more than that, you got to be a C corp. And so those are some of the things. And then there's other rules that come along with being an S corp as well. Like you're required to pay yourself a reasonable compensation or reasonable wage per the IRS. So that means that if you make $100,000, you have to look at what the average salary would be for someone for the type of things you're doing inside your business. So if you're, CEO, you have CEO activities, or you're doing like admin type activities, you need to come up with a salary for yourself. So you will want to probably pay yourself somewhere between $30,000 and $40,000 on payroll. You have to do it through a payroll service. So those are some of the rules with the S corp. I know sometimes people are like, you know, we don't do that, but you know, if it's going to save you tons of money or thousands of dollars, why not? With the C corp, a lot of people have a lot of misconceptions about. Oh, we're going to talk about that later too. One of the things with C corps that people always say is, "Oh, I don't want a C corp because it's double taxation." Mm-hmm. Okay, it's not double taxation for the corporation itself. You are taxed at the corporate level, which is the 21%. So you're taxed on any profits at that rate, and then your shareholders, who you pay dividends to, are then having to pay tax on the dividends that they receive from that corporation.
Okay.
So that's where it gets confusing when it comes to the different entities. And now you're starting to hear more about the B Corps.
I've never heard of that.
Yeah. So this is a new one. Well, it's not new. It's actually been around for a while, but people are just now starting to find out about it. So okay. A B Corp pretty much is a business that decides to align itself with a purpose. So it's a for-profit business that's aligning itself with the purpose. So it almost acts like a nonprofit, but it's not a straight nonprofit, if you get what I mean. So the business has to be certified as a B Corp, and they have to determine how much. So if it's going to be a flat amount or if it's going to be a percentage of their profits that they're going to set aside towards a social and economic purpose. So,
that's interesting.
Yeah. So some companies who are registered B Corps that you may have heard of are like Ben and Jerry's and Seventh Generation, you know, like the laundry detergent that's really good for the environment and everything. They're a registered B Corp. And a lot of the other ones we don't even know about because they're smaller corporations, but they have a big purpose and they've been able to be certified as a B Corp.
That's awesome. So how does someone actually figure out which path they should go down between all these different corporation styles? Is that something that they should go to a tax professional and kind of sit down with you and like have that conversation so that way you guys can determine it together? How does that look?
Yes, for sure. Definitely. And you want to choose someone who is certified in small business that knows, like with an enrolled agent, we're allowed to give tax advice and do more of a consulting. A traditional tax preparer, they're not necessarily always trained on the best practices when it comes to business entities and what structure is going to have the best effect on your tax return. So you may not want to go to just a traditional preparer if they don't know about that information. If it's somebody like me, of course, I knew about it because I studied it and I have my own businesses. Mm-hmm. But you definitely want to make sure that's something that's within their wheelhouse, because the last thing you want to do is have someone give you incorrect advice.
Absolutely.
There's so much information out there. When you Google, you know, it can get very, very confusing.
Yeah.
To really determine what you need. So definitely best to sit down with either a financial advisor, and sometimes they don't even know. CPAs are another alternative, but make sure they have a specialization in taxation, because a lot of CPAs don't. They're really, their main sole purpose is to do like financial reporting and making sure, you know, your balance sheets and your profit and losses and your big financial statements that you need are in good shape. So when they're audited, they're okay, and there's nothing wrong with those. And a lot of them don't necessarily focus on taxes. So sometimes you may find a CPA. I'll give you guys an example. I had a client who had a CPA, and you know, she was like, "Oh, I'm paying, you know, I had to write a $70,000 check to the IRS." And I was like, "Well, why?" "Oh, my CPA did my taxes, and that's what we owe." And I was like, "Oh, okay." I was like, "Well, let me look at it. Maybe we can, you know, see if we could do something better." And she's like, "Oh, but you're not a CPA." I'm like, "Okay, that's fine. Mm-hmm. But give me a chance, you know, take a look at it." And so she did. And needless to say, she's never owed the IRS since then.
Oh, wow. So what did you do differently?
Just really looking and digging into all of their deductions that they could take out. And so that was something that their CPA wasn't doing. Although she was keeping up with their financial reporting and everything that they had to do for their businesses and their investments. And then, you know, also their jobs, because they had W-2 jobs. Then they had investment properties and all kinds of different things going on. And so with that, you know, they were doing the reporting portion of it. But that CPA wasn't necessarily a tax professional or wasn't well versed in actual income taxes. It, you know, you have CPAs that'll do taxes on the side just to make extra income during tax season, but they don't really know about taxes.
That's interesting. So what is something that you feel is like a common misconception within the tax industry?
Common misconception is you're supposed to get a refund every year.
You're supposed to get a refund.
That's the most common one. Because most people think, oh, when I file my taxes, I'm going to get some money back. Right. That's not always the case.
Right.
Actually, getting money back isn't necessarily a good thing unless, you know, you're a W-2 employee and then you have your credits and everything, then that's fine.
Right.
But as a business owner, you know, I see a lot of business owners coming to me and they're always wondering, why am I not getting any money back? And it's kind of like, okay, well, did you pay taxes throughout the year?
No.
If you did not, you're not going to get no money back. I'm sorry. You know, you have, just like me with when I do real estate and everything. So it's like, if I'm not paying quarterly taxes every year, I'm not going to get a refund. You can only get a refund on your business if you're paying taxes throughout the year and you overpay. If you overpay, then you'll get that money back.
So,
but
go ahead.
Yeah. If you change your mindset a little bit and look at it this way, you can, of course, my job is to make sure you owe as little taxes as possible, right? There are ways to kind of get around not paying taxes, like, you know, Trump and Amazon, places like that. But those are, you know, specialized cases. But you just have to think about it as, if you're owing taxes, that's good. That means you're making money. That's a good thing. It's not necessarily a bad thing if you owe taxes. And so you just have to really know, get with a good tax preparer or enrolled agent, or, you know, someone who is specialized in business taxes, so that they can help you save the most amount on your taxes as possible, because you can avoid paying taxes. It is legal to avoid paying taxes. It is illegal to evade. So tax avoidance is legal. Tax evasion is illegal.
That's funny. So what is the main difference between those two?
Main difference between those two, tax avoidance is the IRS states that you have the right as a business owner or a regular tax-paying citizen to avoid taxes. So when they're saying avoid paying taxes, that means whatever you can legally write off or deduct or reduce your tax liability with, you are within your well right to do so. Now, tax evasion, that's what you see a lot of the celebrities going to jail for. That's because they either misrepresented their income, or their accountants misrepresented their income, underreported their income, did not put in all their expenses and everything, and just really misappropriating what they made or spent for the year. So sometimes you'll see them say, oh, okay, well, you know, how does a person like Wesley Snipes owe like so many millions of dollars in taxes? Well, it's because they weren't reporting all of his income properly. And so with that, that became a tax evasion, because now at this point, the IRS feels like you're doing some shady stuff because you don't want to pay Uncle Sam any money. And so that's what tax evasion is. That is when you are misrepresenting your income.
So how... Right. So how do you make sure that you don't end up in those situations? Because, I mean, let's be real. The majority of us are afraid of the IRS because of the fact, I think that it's also comes from lack of education on the IRS and how the code, you know, how things work within that. So I know for me, I rely on whoever is helping me with my taxes to pretty much take care of that, because I have no idea. Like, I just don't know the rules myself.
Right, right. And a lot of people won't ever know the rules, like even tax preparers, and nobody's going to ever know everything, because guess what? The tax code itself changes. Is over 70,000 pages. Yep. I don't know anyone who's going to read all of that. That's why you have some that just kind of pick the parts they want to specialize in and focus in on that. So, you know, definitely to avoid situations like that, it's just to report everything. You know, I say Uncle Sam or Auntie Samantha, whatever you want to call the IRS, they want to know about all the money you make from all around the world. So if you're, for instance, like I work in international real estate and I invest internationally. So if I'm making money from international properties, I have to report to that country and I have to report to my country here. Oh, luckily, wow. The U.S. has treaties with about 65 different countries to where if I pay taxes over in the Dominican Republic, and then I report that here on my income tax return for the United States, I can get a credit for the taxes that I paid to the DR. So I'm essentially getting that money back.
Right. Oh, that's pretty cool.
Yeah. And so a lot of people don't know that. So they get scared. And that's what happens with the whole tax evasion thing, because they're like, oh, well, I'm not going to tell them about the money I made over there. I mean, look what happened to Shakira recently. She was like living in Spain, and then, but she's from Colombia, and then she's traveling all over, making all this money from everywhere. And they're telling her, your domicile, which is your residence, was in Spain. So now you owe Spain money, and you didn't pay Spain. You might have
Oh,
paid all those
wow.
other people, but you didn't pay Spain. So now you owe over here. So now you're in trouble for owing taxes to Spain.
Oh my
So
goodness.
that's where the whole tax evasion part comes in. Sometimes it's done unknowingly, and
Right.
sometimes it's done knowingly.
Right. That's crazy. See, there's just so much to know, even with something as simple as that. Because I wouldn't, personally, I probably wouldn't have thought twice about it. I would have thought, I live in the United States. This is where it's supposed to be, and just pretty
Right.
much left it at that.
Exactly, and that's what a lot of people do. So,
Yeah.
but unfortunately, the IRS doesn't take what they call it. They actually specifically say it. They said they don't accept ignorance as an answer or a reason for you messing up on your taxes.
I will say that it's not fair when it's such a big issue, but it's not taught in schools. But
Exactly,
it's
and these are conversations that we need to start having in school so that people know.
Absolutely.
Because a
Absolutely.
lot of kids are like, oh, I want to grow up and I want to be a rapper, or I want to be a doctor, I want to have my
Right.
own business. And you need to know the tax implications that come with each of those.
Absolutely. Agreed,
Yeah.
100%. Anyway, we do have to go on break real quick,
All right.
guys. So we will be right back with you in just a moment.
All right.
Has openings for 1 hour talk shows. If you want to host a radio show, now is the time. Make KCAA your flagship station. Our rates are affordable and our services are second to none. We broadcast to a population of 5 million people. Plus, we stream and podcast on all major online audio and video systems. If you've been thinking about broadcasting a weekly radio program on real radio plus the internet, contact our CEO at 281-599-9800. 281-599-9800. You can Skype your show from your home to our Redlands, California studio, where our live producers and engineers are ready to work with you personally. A radio program on KCAA is the perfect work from home avocation in these stressful times. Just type kcaaradio.com into your browser to learn more about hosting a show on the best station in the nation, or call our CEO for details. 281-599-9800.
Welcome back to the Journey to Business and Entrepreneurship. This is Brianna. This is a show where we interview businesses and entrepreneurs about their journey and path through business and entrepreneurship. And today I have the pleasure of speaking with LaToya Tillett on taxes. So I actually have a question that I wanted to ask before we went on break, but we were running out of time, so I had to cut it.
No worries.
But anyway, as an LLC, if you need to transition, because you're saying that basically it's useless to have an LLC from my understanding. How do you make that transition from one, from an LLC, for example, to like an S corp or C corp or something like that?
Okay, so it's a pretty simple process, actually. The
Oh.
Secretary of State for California and most other states makes it quite simple. You usually have to just fill out maybe one small form or a couple of pages
Wow.
and complete that to convert your entity over to another structure. I wouldn't say necessarily LLC is completely useless,
Okay.
but if you don't structure it right, it can be. Because that's what a lot of people do, because you can elect to be taxed as a different as an S corp or a C corp when you have the LLC, but you need to make that election within a certain time frame. And then if you file late, then you have to give a big explanation of why you're just now electing to file. And I believe there's like a 2 year time frame on that or something. You can't go past 2 years. You should necessarily do it like within like the first 4 months that you open your LLC. But I know they give you a little bit of time to do so. I can double check that, if people are wondering, or you can kind of look that up and see what that is. But sometimes you may be too far down the line to elect to be taxed as a different entity. And so you may have to just go ahead and work on doing a conversion through the Secretary of State. But it's pretty simple. They have the forms online.
Gotcha.
I've had to do it before. So
oh, okay.
we went from an LP to a C Corp. So oh, okay. It was a really simple process. And I think we had to pay like an additional $150, $200, something like that.
That's not bad. Well, that you made it sound a lot easier than I would have thought. So thought it would be. I thought it would be like this, you know, huge process and having to get approval and all this stuff.
Okay. Yeah. You do the form. I mean, it takes a little bit for the approval. And then, you know, once it's done, you'll receive the confirmation from the state and everything. Or you can, have your tax preparer help you out with that paperwork, or your CPA, or your attorney.
Yeah.
Either way.
So it is fair to, and correct me if I'm wrong, but would you say that it's fair to say that if you have a W-2, this is the kind of thing that you don't necessarily have to worry too much about because you're paying taxes throughout the year. Whereas if you have a small business or if you're 1099, you definitely need to make sure that you're taking, you know, you have someone that's actually helping you. Is that fair to say?
You know, yes and no. It okay. depends on how much money they're making at that W-2 job. You know, if it's like, okay. you know, really basic W-2 from like fast food joint or, you know, grocery store or something mm-hmm. like that, where they're not making a whole heck of a lot. It's under $100,000. In those cases, normally they don't have to worry about anything unless they make the mistake of going exempt or not having enough taxes taken out. So actually, W-2 people, you do need to worry about these things as well, because another thing that I face in my business is people with their W-2s. And although they may have only made $40,000, they had maybe $900 taken out. Like I had a client one time, it was like a $2.72 taken out in federal taxes. Like, what am I going to do with that? So you owe now because you did not have enough taxes withheld. So this is where you have to talk to your HR department and make sure your W-4 form is filled out correctly, so you are getting the correct amount of taxes withheld. Because what's going to happen is you're going to be paying taxes all throughout the year. And you're going to say, hey, you know, they've been taking money out of my check. Why do I owe LaToya? And it's like, well, you did not have enough taken out. So what you need to do, if you are a W-2 employee, you need to look at your income. If you know you're going to be getting a raise that year or have an idea, kind of give yourself an estimate. So if you know you're going from $40,000 to $50,000 this year at your job, go ahead and look at the tax bracket for the current year, because that's where you're going to fall into. And that's going to give you a rough estimate of how much you should be having withheld in taxes.
So,
So everybody needs to worry.
Okay. So the tax bracket, that's something that you can, I assume, is public information that you can find online.
Yeah. So you can just type in, like, you know, because right now we'll be preparing taxes for 2023. So you can go 2023 tax brackets. And then if you're in 2024 to plan, this is still planning. So even W-2 people need to plan ahead of time. So let's say I'm getting a W-2 and I'm like, okay, I've already talked to my boss. I already know I usually get my raise around June. I'm going to go up to this X amount of dollars or whatever. So then you can look at 2024 tax bracket and what that's going to look like. So you can plan for next year. So you can make sure they start withholding the correct amount of money this year, because what you can't do is wait until how we are now in January 2024
right.
to go back and say, oh, you know what? They should have withheld an extra $10,000 in 23. It was too late now. Mm-hmm. So now you got to pay that $10,000 out of your pocket plus whatever money they took out of your check.
That's rough.
Yeah, so, it is. And it's really sad because I see it happen so often throughout different tax seasons, because I also do tax advising for Intuit as well. And so a lot of the customers call me with that same complaint. It's like, oh, but I only made this much more money this year. And why do I owe? And it's like, well, you did not have enough taken out. Or sometimes it's a spouse situation to where one spouse has the correct amount withheld and the other spouse doesn't. So now you guys still owe and everybody's upset about it and they think I'm wrong, but I'm not.
Yeah. So what are
all this information on the internet?
Right. What are ways in which both W-2 people and, well, essentially everyone can prepare for next year's taxes today?
Okay. If you start right now today, start one, get yourself a tracking or filing system. If you're not good at accounting or you're not disciplined enough with accounting to keep up with it, definitely hire an accountant. It is the best investment you can make in your business and in yourself. If you're a W-2 employee, you want to make sure, take a look at those W-4s right now to make sure that you're having enough taxes withheld. So take a look at the current tax brackets for the current income you're at right now, and then make sure that that's in line with your W-4 so they can withhold enough. So if you're supposed to be in the 15% tax bracket and you should be getting at least $7,400 withheld throughout the year, make sure that's what you're getting withheld, because what you don't want to happen is you only get $2,500 withheld and you're wondering why you owe that balance at the end of the year.
Okay. Now, earlier you had mentioned something about paying quarterly as a business rather than waiting until, you know, tax time to pay everything all at once. How does that work exactly?
So that's what they call estimated taxes. So estimated taxes, you can pay at the end of every quarter. You have your due dates and everything lined up. And this is based on the simple fact, it's a really low number. So if you already have an idea that you're going to owe at least $500 or $1,000, something like that, from your profits, then you need to base your estimated tax payments on that. So what I usually tell my clients is, let's look at last year. So let's say, you know, your business did really well last year, mm-hmm. and you owed maybe $10,000 or $20,000 in taxes, right? Mm-hmm. So we want to do the estimate based on that. Or if you have a projection for where you're going, which all business owners, you should have a projection of the income you're going to be planning to make the next year as well. Mm-hmm. I always advise doing at least a 3 or 4 year projection to kind of know where you are. So if you see that you were at, you know, 100,000 last year, and then you're on track to do 250 this year, you want to make sure that you're lining up that those estimated tax payments. So based it on the corporate rate of the 21%, depending on the type of entity you have. But if you have corporation, then it's 21%. And so that's LLC, that's S Corp, C Corp, all of those, right? Mm-hmm. Unless you have nonprofit, then, you know, it's zero. But you want to look at that tax bracket and say, okay, well, if I make every $100,000, I'm going to owe $21,000 in tax. Just assuming that's, you know, net. So you can estimate your payments that way. And the good thing is, if you overpay, they're going to give you that money back. That's when you as an entity can get a refund on your business because you gotcha. Overpaid. Sometimes it's better to overpay than to underpay.
Oh yeah.
Yes. Because what we don't, what happens is a lot of business owners or even employees, a lot of us, we're just not disciplined enough to set that money aside.
Right.
And people don't tell you that, you know, it's kind of like, oh, you think you can handle it. Oh, I'm making money. But then stuff happens, right? Your car breaks down or your office floods, you know, like stuff just comes out of the woodwork and you're like, dang, I don't have the money now. And then now you got this bill from the IRS and you're like, dang, man, like I thought I was going to have it.
Right.
But you don't have it because you weren't, you couldn't put it aside because something happened, or you just aren't disciplined enough to save money towards it. What everyone should be doing. I'll throw out a book recommendation, Read Profit First by Michael Michalowicz. Really, really good book. Definitely tells you how to structure your business and your profits and to line up your accounts so that way you're not surprised when tax season comes up.
Mm, nice. Now, you and I, before we got on this the show, we're just mm-hmm. talking about BOI, I believe it's what it's called. Yes. What is that?
Oh, bill requirement. Newsflash, everyone. If you haven't heard or you've been hearing, guess what? You have to do beneficial ownership information reporting. This is new this year. It was kind of some myths going around out there that everything had to be turned in January 1st of this year. That was not necessarily true. So what it is every corporation, LLC, S-Corp, partnership, pretty much any entity, you have to disclose who all your owners are. So what's happening is, well, I won't say what I think happened. I don't want to but so, you know, back in the day, people would create like shell companies, you know, yeah. offshore accounts, right. different things like that. Are people hiding behind what we call the corporate veil?
Right.
So yeah, IRS says, no, you can't do that no more. Somebody came out with the law. Dang, I want to say it so bad. I just think somebody didn't get their share and they snitched. So now us as business owners, we all have to report who all of our owners are, who all the true owners are of the corporation, who's getting paid off of it, because you have foreign people hiding in corporations. You have politicians hiding in corporations, getting paid off certain things that they're not supposed to be getting paid from. So now that all has to be disclosed. So how it works is Yes, the requirement did begin January 1st of this year. So this month you have to do the reporting, or else there's a $500 per day penalty.
Oh,
Where people
wow.
were getting, yeah, I know,
Per
right?
day.
Where people were getting confused is they thought that the report was due on January 1st. So if you started your business prior to January 1st, 2024, you have until January 1st, 2025 to get your report done and get it filed. And you can file it electronically through FinCEN. The other people, so if you're starting your business this year after January 1st of 2024, you have to have that report done within 3 months. So you have 90 days to get it done, or else it's a $500 per day penalty. And everybody who was before January 21st, 2024, I mean, January 1st, 2024, you file by January 1st, 2025, or else you have a $500 per day penalty. So I don't think anybody wants to get hit with that. So
No,
definitely make
ma'am.
sure you get that
Look, you had when you said 500, I'm like, oh, that's not bad. But then when you said per day, I was like, ooh, never mind.
Yeah, per day that you're late. So let's
Oh, that
say that
is
you were
terrible.
supposed to have it in. It says 90 days. So let's say March 31st, you were supposed to have it done, and you get it done April 15th. So from April 1st to April 15th, it's $500 each day.
Yes. Oh, that's a lot of money.
A lot of money. Like, the IRS, they technically, a little secret that a lot of people don't know, they choose different things to go after every single year. So they have these big meetings and they talk with Congress and they talk amongst themselves within the IRS, and they come up with different things that they're going to audit every year. A lot of people don't know that. So that's why some people
Interesting.
who are doing shady things get to fly under the radar for a long time, because sometimes they're not always focused on that. Like the year that I got audited was the year that they decided to look at everyone who was doing online businesses. And at the time, my husband had online business with eBay, and he was selling on Amazon as well, and making tons of money. And so they're like, "Oh, people are making money with the online stuff. Let's go ahead and check these folks out." So at that time, they started hitting everybody who had online businesses that made over $20,000 or sold over 200 products or something like that. And so we came up in that mix.
Wow.
And the next year they chose something else to audit. And this is something I learned from the IRS auditor himself. So I'm not making up stuff, okay? He literally sat in my house, and this is what this man told me. He said, "Do you know why you're being audited?" And I was like, "No, but can you tell me?" And he's like, "You're being audited because this year we decided that these are the businesses we're going to go after." Then the next year, sometimes they decide, I forgot what year it was, they decide to focus solely on Schedule C businesses.
You are such
And
a wealth of information. My goodness. I see, this is what I appreciate about having you on the show. But we're pretty much wrapping up at this point, but we do have to go on our last break, so we'll be right back with you guys in just a little
All
bit.
right.
KCAA Radio has openings for 1 hour talk shows. If you want to host a radio show, now is the time. Make KCAA your flagship station. Our rates are affordable and our services are second to none. We broadcast to a population of 5 million people. Plus, we stream and podcast on all major online audio and video systems. If you've been thinking about broadcasting a weekly radio program on real radio plus the internet, contact our CEO at 281-599-9800. 281-599-9800. You can Skype your show from your home to our Redlands, California studio, where our live producers and engineers are ready to work with you personally. A radio program on KCAA is the perfect work from home avocation in these stressful times. Just type kcaaradio.com into your browser to learn more about hosting a show on the best station in the nation, or call our CEO for details. 281-599-9800.
Welcome back to the Journey to Business and Entrepreneurship. My name is Brianna. This is the show where we interview businesses and entrepreneurs, learning more about them, their business, and how they came to be. Today we have Latoya Tillett, who is a tax professional, and I'm so grateful to have had you on, Latoya. It's been fun. I just, it's always funny because I feel like the shows always go by so quickly, like an hour. You know, I remember back when I first started, I thought 30 minutes was just fine. And when I heard an hour, I was like, an hour? But now it's like it goes by so quickly.
It does, especially when you're having fun or it was good conversation. You
yeah,
know?
Absolutely. And you've been great. Great advice. I love it.
Yeah.
Now, one thing that I do want to ask you, because I'm sure that everybody has questions when it comes to taxes, even if you have a good tax professional. Mm-hmm. Is there any advice that you would give to somebody who has a business, who knows that they need to have, you know, proper, you know, things set up, but maybe mm-hmm. hasn't quite gotten there yet?
Advice for them would be, of course, to sit down with someone to find out. You know, I offer 15-minute free consultations. I also have an event scheduled for the next 6 weeks. I'm going to be doing weekly Q&A sessions.
Oh, that's and so awesome. So if
anyone's interested, where you can come and you can ask me anything in regards to taxes. Now, there is a small fee for it. It's $25 because I don't want you to think that I'm just throwing off surface information, stuff that you can find on Google. We'll be talking more in depth about what tax questions you have. So it's $25. You can find it on eventbrite.com and it's called Tax Tea with Toya. Okay. Mm-hmm. So Tax Tea with Toya, you can sign up and it's every Wednesday for the next 6 weeks, starting January 17th at 6 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. You can go on there and come and we can talk about your taxes. And if you go ahead and sign up, and you come to the actual event, I will offer you a $50 coupon towards your tax preparation.
Hey, look at that.
For those
that's awesome.
Who are interested. Yeah.
And Tax Tea, is that Tax TEA?
Or... Yes.
Okay. Just wanted to make sure that was clear.
Yeah. So Tax TEA. So it's Tax TEA with Toya, and that's TOYA. And that's on Eventbrite. You can register for any of those sessions that are coming up and we can go in detail and talk more about taxes. We can talk more about section 162 of the IRS code and section 169. Cause I know there's a lot of confusion with those.
Wait, LaToya, you can't just throw those out there and not say what that is. I'm like, wait, what's these numbers?
Section 162 of the IRS code. This is the code that every single business owner needs to live by. Okay. Mm. This is when you hear
secrets.
About people talking about, yeah, this is when people are talking about tax loopholes. This okay. is the main one for businesses. So section 162, it states that you are able to write off anything that is ordinary and necessary for your business. Okay. And where people get confused is they try to generalize the deductions and they just say, oh, you know, you can write off this, that, and you might have like a standard list of deductions, mm-hmm. but there may be some stuff that's a little out of the box, you know, like somebody might have had to buy a yacht for their business. And people are like, why are you buying a yacht for your business? Well, if you showcase waterfront properties,
I remember you mentioning that last time.
Yes. Waterfront luxury properties, you need to jump, you know, you might have to take them out there on that yacht. So that was an ordinary and necessary part of the business for the type of business she does. I sell real estate internationally. So it's ordinary and necessary for me to jump on planes all the time and stay in hotels and travel to different destinations. People miss some of those deductions because of that. So
my advice,
live by it.
My advice to everyone, definitely check out and schedule with LaToya. She's going to be doing it for the next 6 weeks anyway. Get the advice that she can provide. LaToya, thank you so much for coming on. I appreciate you.
Thank you, Brianna. It's so fun.
Absolutely.
I appreciate it.
Absolutely. Have a great Sunday, everyone.